enjoying myself sitting there at the back ever since morning, because it's like everything was building up to my presentation, and I enjoyed myself. But it was brilliant presentations we got this morning. But I want to, okay, fine. So we've been talking about e-infrastructures and all these nice things that we're trying to do, all these services. In other presentations that came already, we saw that there are these G libraries, the open access repository and stuff. And I believe when Sci-GaIA started this project, they adopted an approach which was, in one documentary I watched by the Crown Prince of Dubai, the Sheikh. He says, "Build Dubai and they'll come." So don't worry about it was a sand desert, and everyone was saying, "What could come out of this place?" And the guy simply said, "Let's build it and they'll come." And they did come. They did come. So Sci-GaIA, I'm sure they took the same approach. They said, "Look, let's build the infrastructure, let's build the projects, and people will come." And here we are coming for real. But anyway, so I want to actually do the bridge to say, okay, fine. So the technologies are here and they've been built. The scientists are here and they need to use the technology. But there isn't that bridge that's coming, and how do we attain the bridge? And I think part of what we can do is to actually show that the infrastructure works. Prof. Roberto in the morning spoke about distributed computing platforms to provide the much needed computational power, which was quite interesting. And one of the things that these distributed computing platforms are is a grid computer. And my presentation simply says, look, let's compare a computational grid and a high-end multi-core server. A high-end multi-core server is already built for high-end processing. It's built for high-throughput processing. And a lot of people, since morning, we're talking about these simulations and so much computing power that is needed to attend the simulations in science, engineering, and all these sorts of things. But at the same time, we've got that backdrop where academic institutions do not have enough money. Last year, there was FISMAS 4, and there is no money to keep on buying these things. So my presentation actually says, okay, fine, so what do we have? We've got an increasing demand in more computational resources in those fields, in simulation, data mining, and climate forecasting. And we also have a high cost of acquiring these high-performance servers or high-performance multi-core machines. But at the same time, we've got an issue of underutilization. Universities, academic institutions are procuring machines and computers to use there, but we don't fully utilize them. This is a common problem everywhere. I looked at a particular case of the Northwest University, but it is a common problem. Computers are available. We've got labs that get locked at night and people go home, and for 12 hours they are sitting. But in that 12 hours, can we not use them? Can we not tap into them and process, since we want this high-end processing? The final lab by Isaac, it also brought these very nice things about high-performance computing in academia, which Isaac was talking about in his final lab and things that he wants to propose. And Jocelyn spoke about scalability of application somewhere I caught on a conversation. So I was enjoying myself when I was sitting there, because like these things were like building to my presentation. But this is there, and the man is Bruce. This is a generic representation of the South African national grid. So you've got some grid sites, some clusters, these are universities. You've got a few private sites, you've got the CSIR there, and you've got the CHPC in Cape Town. And any other institution can join this federation and become part of it, and what you benefit from joining this federation. By joining this federation, you simply get to tap into other computational resources that you don't have on site. So you're literally beginning to solve the issues that rise in the issues that we're talking about of the demand and the increasing need for that computational power. Clearly, research has shifted. Back then, people used to come up with theories and everything, then they do the practical later on. But now people experiment just for seeing what happens. Let's run an experiment and see what happens. There is no proposition that they start with. They're just saying, look, I think it would be interesting to see the results of this. So because of that, this becomes a very good platform. So this becomes a very good platform to use. Of course, it comes with its other things. All right. Why did I like Jocelyn's presentation? She spoke about application scalability at some point, how you can actually scale applications and the kind of things. But the paper that I wrote on this is a paper that looked at a scientific comparison. And I'm saying, look, there are many comparisons that you can have. You can have application scalability. You can compare architecture. This we have seen. You can compare design workflow. But the combination of these two are very powerful. When you compare architecture and you compare design workflow, you put those two together to see, okay, fine, you have this particular architecture, you have this particular designs and workflow. When you bring the two together, what do you have? And this particular case for me was interesting because then industry can acquire this powerful specialized processing machine, and they do have. But in the academic environment, we keep on getting left behind. So that's what I decided to look at. All right. It's a high-level description of how this thing happened. From there, the research design, the research method, but I don't want to bore you with this. There was a bit of data analysis that went in there to do descriptive statistics. Then, of course, it's a comparison, so you need to scientifically show whatever you are alleging. So that's the high-level description of the process which was taken. If you look at that, it says we had an experiment and a narrative. So we took two particular real-life scenarios. One of them was the support vector machine application, which is pretty much compute-intensive. And we said, okay, fine, with the support vector machine application, if we run it on both systems, what do we find? There was a multi-core server adopted for this particular experiment. And then we said, okay, fine, let's go into the national grid, South African national grid. Let's choose one site. And we chose a site, and we ran a few experiments on that. And when we ran the experiments, we actually realized that we produced these results. These were just data sizes that are represented by these 2K, 6K, and 12K. And in terms of the simple turnaround time, this is basically what we found. And from what we found in simple turnaround time, we find, if you look at the graph properly, you'll find that the multi-core server, which is given as the local server, performed relatively better than the grid computer for obvious reasons. The machine, that particular machine is built for high-end processing. And because it's a standalone machine, you don't have other issues like network issues and other stuff. So it performed better, but the performance was not that different in smaller data sets than in bigger data sets. And part of what we find is that the granularity of data will determine how the server scales. So if it's fine-grained data, the grid will do just fine, because then we can distribute the data as much as possible. The variation in performance was crazy. You can see the grid there, it went bizarre. The variation in performance. Then the question was, why? Why is it happening this way? And then we realized that, of course, there's an important a process that we undertake when we're using that particular grid. There's something we call data staging. So data staging is the process of moving your data from the metadata service by the logical file catalog and putting it over to the site where you're processing it. So you have data that sits at a central repository, some metadata service somewhere. When you start processing, what the cream does, it actually says, okay, fine, let's pull the data from wherever it's sitting. So the data is pulled from wherever it's closest to. Now, that process, because of network, I'll keep on putting the nice gentleman at the back on the spot. He's part of SANREN. So, sometimes because of network issues, the data does not get staged as quick as in other instances. And for that reason, that's why that variation becomes that. Because that variation simply says the predictability of the turnaround time for this experiment in the grid, because of that data staging time, we can't really know. If the data staging time takes longer, then the experiment will take longer to complete. If it takes a shorter period of time, then it will take a shorter period of time. Then we said, okay, fine. So let's remove that data staging. Let's remove that data staging effect. And how did we remove it? We said, okay, fine. Let's take the minimum data staging time that we got and make that standard data staging time, and then processing time, let's not change it. And when you change that, you see that in terms of the variation starts behaving a bit normal. But of course, on your computational grid, it still is a bit higher than on your local server. And in terms of now performance, in the other case, it was the local server performed up to 4 times better than the grid. But now the performance has been significantly reduced. It's now up to 2 times. But and then we did another one. We did another one, and there also it performed up to somewhere around 2 times better than the computational grid. The results were expected. We, from the start, we expected the local server to perform better than the multi-core server to perform better than the grid, because that machine is built for processing. But we also wanted to find out what are the other things that we could learn from that whole process, and what are the positive lessons could we take off from that. And what we found in our findings, we actually found that there are a lot of advantages on one system against the other. It's like we can't compare apples and oranges, because we didn't do things like standardization of the floating point operations and stuff on that particular system. So we said, okay, fine. So what do we learn from that? And part of what we learn from this, and part of what we observe, is that the grid, which is our e-infrastructure in this case, actually allows abstraction of workflows. So when you have an experiment to configure on the particular two systems, on one, once it's done, you put it onto code RAID, it's ported, it stays there. On your server, you have to install, which is easier because you're taking it from your Linux repositories. But what happens is when you move from one server to the next, you need to reinstall. And on the grid, your information is literally sitting there, your bunch of scripts. So anytime you can actually go processing. All right, fine. Data allocation can also be, of course, abstracted, because now we're not storing things on the particular machine that's processing, but we're storing things on a metadata service. And I've, for crying out loud, you just said, okay, fine, the open access repository, just to give an example. So you're storing things somewhere where you're saying, even when I want to process from Pretoria, Joburg, Cape Town, Italy, all these things are already sitting somewhere. So you don't need to worry about data being on your particular machine. All right, the ease of collaboration, which is apparently why we're here. This is open science. We're talking about open science. We need to easily collaborate without any barriers. It's like research that knows no boundaries. And the grid gives us very good ease of collaboration, because we can literally share these things on the platform, and I can just give you the location where the data is, I can give you the location where the scripts are and everything else, and off you go to do this kind of stuff. Of course, the services are free. That service is free of charge. So whether you take your data and it's processed on the University of Johannesburg, you don't need a friend from UJ to be able to use their site. Once you are part of the federated identity, and you're part of the federation, you can process anywhere without worrying about who's maintaining it, who's doing what. So you get all these nice advantages. Okay, the grid also gives you redundancy. When you're running on one server and the machine fails, look, you are stuck. Once it dies, it dies. But if you're on the grid, you can literally just, the work gets taken back from the machine that has failed, and it's reprocessed somewhere else. Okay, we've got all these back-end services, which is also part of the reason why Sci-GaIA has been very good to some of us. Things like G-Library, the logical file catalog. G-Library was actually used in this particular research. Of course, we also have got the availability of computing resources, quite a number of computing resources, because you're pulling computers together to do one task. So the computing resources become more. And of course, it then becomes very easy with this kind of a platform to be able to easily build communities of practice that Bro spoke about in the morning. Because we're saying in the communities of practice, we want people with a common goal, who want to achieve a common thing at the end of the day, to come together and work together. And if we are already talking at that level, it becomes easier to group people and then build communities of practice. All right, it has got its disadvantages, things that we didn't like quite much, and one of them is inconsistencies in data staging time, if we can improve on the network, that goes away. Access to the grid, of course, was difficult. Yeah, you know, if I didn't know Bruce, there was no way I would have gotten into that thing, because there is no documentation. These people don't write. They are so good at what they do, they assume everyone is equally good at what they do. So there is no documentation on the system, and that could improve. And this is actually one thing I also wanted to caution the Sci-GaIA project, to say, look, have we properly documented all the nice work that we've done? Because without it, it can't be used. It's only going to be used by people in this room who have been exposed to the expect. But beyond that, then it can be used, which is some of the things that we encountered. Of course, you needed these site administrators, you needed to rely on the expects, and sometimes you had network problems, which we can do away with. All right, and of course, the multi-core server, we know the generic advantages we get there. It's easy to quick to set up experiments there. You have got a bit more control. The service is easily predictable on how you can get things done and what time, because it's one system. Of course, it also comes with these disadvantages, which are less redundancy, access to the local server is affected negatively, the load balancing techniques and things like the server does not promote easy sharing of data, and there's no abstraction of workflows. And sometimes if there's no dedicated server administrator, like what we find in many academic institutions, you get problems of even outdated software. But all these things, where do they take us? These things simply tell us, okay, fine. So we can separate the two systems entirely, because a multi-core server can also be part of a distributed computing platform. But we can actually use both of them together. So our research kind of informed researchers on the choices that they have, and also academic institutions that are not part of the diagram that I projected could actually join this. And if they join that, they would easily get more resources. They can hire site administrators to maintain that. They will probably... academic institutions should also promote open science in education. But for a researcher, if you want to easily collaborate, and if you're a mobile person and you want to still get work done even when you're off-site, the grid is your way to go. Of course, the long-term retention of applications that are ported to systems like CodeRed would also be good. And of course, the grid could also come as a platform to mitigate the enormous need for high-end throughput computing. So this is what we found in our research, and the approach that we just took is, okay, fine, the systems are there, they've been built. Let's not keep talking about them or comparing them without showing at least something. So let's show something to say, look, if we move over to the system, it works. And here's an example that the system works. So that's the work that was done on that. And for that, of course, Sci-GaIA is greatly appreciated for the support and resources, the exposure. Of course, to Bruce, I think most of these things would have been possible if he had not weighed in on some of these things. So yeah, of course, that's the work that was done, and thank you.